I think it was Yogi Berra who said, I'm paraphrasing, that predicting is a risky business, except especially if it's about the future. So to deal both with Armageddon and a prophecy of the return is a difficult and serious subject. And when I started writing my books, which began almost 40 years ago, the first book was titled The 12th Planet, I knew then, almost 40 years ago, that whatever volume the final one in that series called The Earth Chronicles will be, it will have to deal with the end of days, which is the name given by the Bible, in the Bible, to prophecies of the last days, the end time, and any other way that the term in Hebrew, which is Acharit HaYamim, is rendered. And I really delayed writing that final book for two reasons. Number one is that I felt I need to do more research, and actually it took another 30 years of research to be able to give a plausible answer, one which I believe is the correct answer, but at least it should be sufficiently documented to be plausible. And the other reason is that I don't know if everybody will be happy with the conclusions of that book, The End of Days. Certainly, I think many of those that are dealing, specializing in the subject of what's about to happen, have focused recently on 2012 AD. If I wanted to be nasty, which maybe I should be, is I can tell you right off that the only thing certain about 2012 that there'll be another presidential election then, and that no matter who you vote for this time, you will say, let's get rid of the bum. because otherwise, what is supposed to happen in 2012? It is mostly linked with the so-called Mayan calendar or Mayan prophecies, and I'll talk about it in greater detail as we go along. But as I understand what others are saying, is that it is a time that something, the present, the past, will come to an end, and something will happen. And when you are pressing those others who specialize in 2012, and you ask them what will happen, they say, well, there's a planet. There's a planet that makes some great orbit and periodically comes to our vicinity, and at that time it causes all kinds of havoc. And connection or in response to such kinds of prophecies, my answer is that to remind the audience that the same claims were made in regard, I don't know why, but in regard to 2003. And that's when the planet, the unknown planet, Planet X, will arrive and do all kinds of unpleasant things to us, or maybe good things. And if you will recall, the same kind of prophecies were connected with the millennium, the year 2000. And one way or another, they are always coming back to planet X. And if you say, what is planet X? Well, that is the planet about which this guy Sitchin has been writing. So what is this planet X, and when really is it supposed to come back to our vicinity, and what is supposed to happen when it does? I started to write about it, as many of you may know, in my first book, The 12th Planet. It took me more than 30 years to research that material for that book. It was published the first time in 1976. The English, not hardcover and softcover, but the paperback edition, which is still selling everywhere, had about 50 printings by now, which is a record for the publishers. And the book has been translated into some 24 languages, and I can share with you a personal irritation, and that is that one recent night I was awakened from a sleep, which is not easy for me lately to fall asleep, and the phone, which is also a fax machine, rang around 12:30 a.m. And when I checked who's trying to reach me at this time, a fax from Hanoi that the publisher in Vietnam wants to translate into Vietnamese The 12th Planet. And though, you know, it's been translated by now to almost any language you can think of, I was thinking to myself, somebody in Vietnam, in Hanoi, after all that that place means to us, this is really something. Now what I did in The 12th Planet, and maybe that is the reason for its success and for its still being so powerfully around, is that I brought to life a civilization that was hardly known before, and that is the Sumerian civilization. I find it, although now more and more I find in articles, in other books, etc., reference to the Sumerian civilization, to the Sumerians, I find that it's still easier for even those who deal with that, like museums, to say Babylonian. For example, there is now in Europe an exhibit from ancient Mesopotamia, where three museums, the one in London, in Paris, and in Berlin, have combined to put together some of their objects and show them in each one of the three places, and they refer to it as the Babylonian exhibit. So almost 40 years ago, when I or anybody else would say to somebody, well, you know, the Sumerian civilization, you would get some kind of a blank look, you know, the Sumerian, you know, what are you talking about? So I brought to life the Sumerian civilization, which was really a most amazing civilization. It blossomed out in what is now southern Iraq, in that part of the world. This is the ancient Near East, this is the Mediterranean Sea, the Red Sea, Egypt, Assyria, Turkey, which was the Hittites then, etc. So about 6,000 years ago, an incredible civilization appeared there, and all those that deal with it use such words as suddenly, unexpectedly, out of nowhere, because there was no gradual or any kind of precedential civilization that you had this and this and this, and this is was a higher level, a higher stage. Suddenly, from what we may call primitive, though they were not primitive people, but you know, they were farmers, hunters, etc. But suddenly there appeared cities, high-rise buildings, societal organization, kings, priests, codes of law, literature, art, music, musical instruments, all of that within a very short period appeared about 6,000 years ago. And I sometimes find it necessary to ask people to stop for a minute and think, what is 6,000 years? So we are about 2,000 years removed from the time of Jesus. Now, that time was about 2,000 years removed from the time of Abraham. And then add to that another 2,000 years, and that's where we are talking about, where this great civilization appeared so suddenly. And without devoting the whole evening to that civilization and all the firsts to which we owe a debt. For example, if you look at your watch and you have 60 minutes in an hour, why do you have 60 minutes? Because that's the basic Sumerian mathematical system called sexagesimal base 60. They went from 1 to 60, and then, like we go from 1 to 100 and 101, then we go, they went from 1 to 60 and then 61, so there was base 60. A circle has 360 degrees. Why? Because it is 60 times 6. Indeed, the whole Sumerian mathematical system was based on that. 6 times 10 times 6 times 10, etc. So you had 6 and 60 and 360 and 3,600 and so on and so forth, up to very high numbers in going here. Some tablets were found with starting with mathematical tables with 2,196,000 and tables of divisions from that. So the legacy of Sumer, be it in the first wheel and so on and so forth, is really incredible. So, but I want to mention tonight at least three of their firsts. One is writing. They developed a writing system called cuneiform, where they were described using a stylus would make wedge-like symbols or indentations in wet clay, which when it dried would become a permanent record. I don't have a sample of a tablet with me, but let's say that this is a clay tablet, and I once held up a copy of my book, not this one, this is a DVD, and I said, which one of the two do you think would last another 1,000 years? The printed book or the clay tablet? And the answer is the clay tablet. So we have writing, which of course meant a language and grammar and literature and epic tales, and lullabies were written down, recipes. For example, in the book, The 12th Planet, I give as an example a recipe for what the French call coq au vin, meaning a chicken cooked in wine. There were proverbs. It's really mind-boggling, but I won't spend the whole evening on that. So writing was one of them. Another thing was pictorial depictions. They took stones, mostly semi-precious stones, and made cylinders about an inch or so, sometimes longer, but basically about an inch, a cylinder of an inch, and would engrave, and nobody has figured out to this day how, in this hard stone, they would make an engraving in reverse, like a negative, which when rolled on wet clay would become a permanent permanent depiction, the way we say print our presses, the rotary presses now, the newspapers. So literally thousands of cylinder seals, and even more so, their imprints have been found and any museum worth its salt has these cylinder seals or their imprints on display. And those depictions tell us a lot, and I will refer to some of them. And the third thing that I would like to mention and stress this evening was the high-rise buildings. They were the first to use bricks and to build high-rise buildings, like stage pyramids that would rise 100, 120, 160 or more feet high. Some think that these were the towers of Babel, mentioned in the Bible. Actually, it's not so, but every major city, Sumerian city, had a sacred precinct, and the sacred precinct had such a ziggurat, as they were called. And they were used primarily for astronomical observation. And indeed, their knowledge of astronomy, or in the field of astronomy, is one of the most amazing Sumerian legacies. This is, for example, the imprint of a cylinder seal. You can actually see the seal in Jerusalem. There's a museum there called Bible Lens Museum. And this is, if you ask a regular scholar, what is it, they'll show it. He'll say this is a beer drinking scene, because the Sumerians were also the first to invent beer. And drinking beer was a social event. You can see people are coming to participate in that, and beer was drunk through a straw. The way I understand in, say, in Latin America or in Argentina, they drink mate tea with a straw. But as many other cylinder seals, they were decorated with celestial symbols. And if you study this one, you find out that it depicts the sun, it depicts the earth and its moon, it depicts what we call the asteroid belt, which is a belt orbiting between Mars and Jupiter, and nobody knows, or nobody, I mean, I say nobody because I do. Others claim they don't know how it came about. It's the remains of some planet that was destroyed, exploded, except that if a planet explodes, the pieces fly in all directions, and in this case, they orbit like a belt between Mars and Jupiter. So you also have Mars and Jupiter, here's Jupiter. You have the asteroid belt, which we have discovered only in modern times. And beyond Jupiter, you have Saturn and its rings, which we did not know about until the invention of the telescope. Now, this cylinder seal is from about 2000 BC, from 4,000 years ago. So this is an example of the amazing Sumerian knowledge in astronomy. But there is even one more amazing cylinder seal, which caused quite an uproar at the museum where it's kept. It's in a museum in Berlin at the time when I came across its existence. It was East Berlin, but they cooperated with me. They sent me a photograph. And if you ask scholars what what is the scene depicted, they say, well, this is the god of agriculture granting the plow, a primitive plow, to mankind. A representative of mankind is introduced by a lesser god to the main god who grants the plow. And just as an aside, I'll say so, you tell those same scholars at the museum or in any of their scientific magazines, say, so there was a god of agriculture, and that's how you look. They say, no, that's a mythological scene. That's just mythology. But whatever it is, there is an interesting celestial depiction on this one, and this is what it shows. It shows a star surrounded by planets. Now, this arrow is my addition to enable comparison with our knowledge of the solar system. So we have the sun, not the Earth, we have the sun in the center, surrounded by planets, all the planets we know of in the correct sizes and in the correct order. Except that here there's one more planet, right here, between Mars and Jupiter, where the asteroid belt is now. So according to the Sumerians, there was a planet there, probably, or one must conclude, the planet which apparently broke up somehow. Now, if you could get hold of Sumerian guy and said to him, what planet was that and what is the somehow, how did that planet break up? He'll say, well, that's you're asking me something that has been written about in one of our books. It happens to be a clay tablet, not the way we think of books. And that tablet is actually part of seven tablets. And once they were discovered in a library in northern Mesopotamia, in an ancient library in northern Mesopotamia, and the contents of that story on those tablets was deciphered, they have since been referred as the seven tablets of creation, paralleling the biblical tale of the 7 days of creation, 6 days of actual creation, and then one day in praise of the Creator. So this is one of the tablets, I think the fourth one out of the seven, known as the Epic of Creation, or sometimes known by its opening lines, which is how the Sumerians used to name their epic tales or their tablets in library catalogs, because they were actually set in libraries, and on each shelf there was a tablet that listed all the texts that are on that particular shelf, like a catalog tablet. So no, it's not sometimes known by its opening words, Enuma, Enuma Elish. Now, what does the Enuma Elish say? The Enuma Elish says, tells the story how the Earth came to be, how our moon came to be, how that extra planet came to be, and indeed how the whole solar system came to be. And I devote in the 12th planet, and then in another book, Genesis Revisited, chapter after chapter to explaining this epic of creation. But I'll just give you now the the gist of it in a couple of minutes. And they say that once the solar system began to coalesce, the way our modern scientists say, around our sun, and the various planets began to form, an invader, another planet, thrust out of some other solar system, passed near ours. But as it passed near our solar system, it began to be pulled in by the gravitational pull of all those other planets and changed course. Now you will notice an interesting thing, that while all the other planets rotate in one direction, which is counterclockwise, as we say, this one orbits in the opposite direction, which being unusual is called retrograde. But as it was drawn in the opposite direction, inevitably it collided with one of the olden planets in our solar system, which in the Enuma Elish text is called Tiamat. And this planet, the invader, which later was named Nibiru, acquired various satellites or moons as it was passing by the other planets. Tiamat, which is treated as a female celestial entity, had 11 satellites, one of them quite large, unusually large, called in the tale Kingo. And when the clash finally occurred, referred to in those texts as the celestial battle. Tiamat was hit twice, actually. This is just one of the drawings from my books. Was hit by some of the moons, the satellites of the invader, and was broken up. Half of it became bits and pieces, the asteroid belt, which those texts, and the Bible in chapter 1 of Genesis refers to as the hammered bracelet, because it orbits like a bracelet around the sun. And the other half was thrust into another orbit, carrying with it Tiamat's largest moon to become our planet Earth and its satellite, the moon, an unusually large one as things go in our solar system. Now, without spending time this evening on the subject, but it's in my various other books, for example, you know what modern science says about our planet Earth, that all the continents used to be on one side. On the other side was just a huge cavity that was filled with water, and it's still called the Pacific Ocean. If you read about the origin of the moon, etc., it all corroborates, it all agrees with this Sumerian cosmogony. Now, what happened to the invader? According to the Enuma Elish, the Epic of Creation, the invader itself became a member of the solar system, a 12th member, because they counted the sun, the earth, its moon, and not 9, but 10 planets. So when I discussed with my first publisher the title, the suggested title for my book, the first book, The 12th Planet, I tried to explain to him that this is really the 10th planet, which is the 12th member of the solar system. And he said, Sitchin, we'll call it the 12th planet. So it is known as the 12th planet, though it is in reality the 10th planet. And all the Sumerian tales do include the planet we call Pluto as part of the tale. So I wrote on my website a piece when the astronomers meeting in Europe decided to dethrone Pluto and said it's not really a planet, it's a planetoid, it's this. I wrote a piece on my website and said let Pluto stay the way the Sumerians had it. So this is the planet that remains in orbit and has been renamed Nibiru. Now, on many Sumerian and afterwards Assyrian, Babylonian, and so on, depictions, all the 12 members of the solar system are depicted, and you can see the sun, you can see the moon, you can see this Nibiru, whose symbol became the winged disk, you can see all the others with their symbol, and you can see the 7 dots, which is the symbol for Earth. Now, you may well say this is wrong, because we all know that Earth, in New Age parlance, is the 3rd rock from the sun. Right? So there's Mercury, Venus, and Earth. And that is true. But if the Sumerian incredible knowledge was given them, was not acquired by them from their own observations without telescopes and all other modern equipment, if it was given them by somebody, let's assume for the moment, coming in from outside the solar system towards Earth, then they would say Pluto is the first. And then there's Neptune and Uranus. And then there's Saturn and Jupiter. And Mars would be the 6th planet. And Earth would be the 7th planet. So Earth is quite correctly depicted by the symbol of the 7 dots, the number 7. And this is something I would like you to keep in mind as we proceed with this presentation, because it is very significant towards an appreciation of the evidence from the past about the future. Now, the obvious question that anyone, including myself at the time that I started to research and investigate all that, would ask himself is, how could possibly the Sumerians know all that, that the sun is in the center, and that's how this solar system came into being, and there was an invader, and the invader has this great elliptical orbit, etc. And the answer again, it is written. It is written down on, they are not called tablets, they are called cylinders, square cylinders in this case. And this one in particular, another one like it, can be seen by any one of you if you go to England, to Oxford, to the Ashmolean Museum. And this is called the Sumerian King List. And it says that about 430,000 years before the deluge, a people called Anunnaki, in this text, called Anunnaki, came from their planet and visited Earth and brought civilization to Earth. In fact, it says this in other records like it, say that civilization was brought down, and the term used in the Sumerian for the civilization is kingship. That kingship was brought down first time before the deluge, and was brought down to Earth from the heavens the second time after the deluge. And then there are tales, very detailed tales, telling us that at one time, a group of 50 Anunnaki, led by a leader whom they call Enki, came from their planet, that same planet, the planet X, or Nibiru, came to Earth, and they did not crash land here. Their spacecraft was not just passing by, and they said to each other, hey, look at that rock down there, let's take a look at it. They came for a reason, they came for a purpose, and the purpose was that they needed gold. They needed gold with which to protect the dwindling atmosphere on their own planet. And the tales, which are very detailed, then tell how Enki came and tried to obtain the gold, how his attempts to get it, to extract some gold from the waters of the Persian Gulf did not succeed, so they had to turn to actual mining, and then another leader was sent, called Enlil, and et cetera, so what happened. And there are many statues of Anunnaki, male, female, but this one of Enki is the only one where his fist, if you can discern it, is made of gold, which I believe indicates the purpose for which he came. Now, Enki stayed on Earth quite a long time, and at some point felt that he ought to tell his story of what happened on their planet that made him and his group and the other Anunnaki come to Earth, and what happened on Earth after they came and landed here. And there is an actual text known to any Sumerian or Assyriologist, as some call themselves, that they will say, yes, there is such a text, that is an autobiography of Enki, that starts by saying, when I approached the Earth, I saw greenish marshes. We splash landed in the waters. We waded ashore. I commanded so-and-so, and the name is given, to test water and see if there's potable water. I commanded so-and-so to build us some kind of shelter. I commanded so-and-so to see if there is edible food. And so on and so on, line after line, in those tablets. Unfortunately, the complete text of that autobiography of Enki has not been found, only fragments of it. I used about 800 different sources to reconstruct the story of Enki, because I felt at some point in my own writings that it is not enough to tell the story of what happened here through the prism of the Sumerians, or to some extent the Old Testament, the Hittite writings, etc. But it is also important, in especially, to know why they came, what happened on their planet before they came, through the eyes and through the speech of one of them. And I chose Enki because he did dictate an autobiography. And the tale that emerges from all those sources is that after they landed here and could not get the gold just by extracting it from the waters of the Persian Gulf. This is the Persian Gulf, and this is today's Iraq. Another leader, a half-brother of his called Enlil, came. He was a more a commander, and he was more a scientist. Another member of their family, they were all children of the ruler of Nibiru, called Anu. Another member, a female, who was a medical doctor, came and assisted also. And they set up a settlement, or actually seven settlements on Earth, at a place that they called in Sumerian Edin, from which the word Eden, the Garden of Eden, comes. They chose a central point called Nippur. They nicknamed the navel of the earth, because all the other settlements that they established, each one with a certain purpose, including this one as the spaceport, and this laid out as a landing corridor, all of them were equidistant from Nippur. So Nippur was the central city, the site where Enlil had his headquarters, and some of the texts even describe what was at his headquarters, and there was a particular place there called the Duranki, with all kinds of humming equipment that controlled the space flights and gave information about orbits, etc. And Duranki literally means the bond heaven-earth, the thing that links heaven, their own planet, in this great orbit, and their settlements on Earth. So this is what they established. And as I said, at some point, the idea of extracting gold from the waters didn't work. They had to go and do it the hard way. So they kept coming in groups of 50 until there were some 600 of them on Earth. And they used Mars as a way station, on which 300 of them were stationed. The numbers are given in those texts. But most of those on Earth, those Anunnaki, were assigned to mining gold in East Africa. And there are several texts, and in particular one known as the Atrahasis Epic, that describe a time or an event where those working in the mines mutinied. And they said, no more. This is not the kind of work that we can do. We are astronauts. We are supposed to man spacecraft, not to work deep in the earth. And there was a mutiny. And there was great consternation among the leadership what to do. And then the same Enki, who was a scientist, said, we don't have to abandon our efforts to obtain the gold on which our own survival on our planet depends, because we have to protect our dwindling atmosphere with a shield of gold particles. Because there exists on Earth, already exists on Earth, a being which is in many ways similar to us. And all we have to do, and those are quotes from his words in his autobiography, all we have to do is put our mark on it, our genetic mark, and thereby raise that being more to our level so that it could follow our commands, understand our language, and do the work for us. And there are quite a number of texts called creation texts that describe how Enki, with the help of their half-sister, who was the chief medical officer, through trial and error, kept trying to combine their genes with the genes of the being that they found on Earth, which we may call Homo erectus if we wish, and finally succeeded in bringing about what was called in those texts the perfect model. And it so happens that there is a cylinder seal about 4,000 years old showing this goddess, her name was Ninmah, raising the newborn model men, Lulu Amelun, as they called it. And she shouted, and these are words in those texts, "My hands have made it." That is, ladies and gentlemen, how we came about. This is the long story, which I gave you as briefly as I could, of what the Bible says in chapters 2 and others of Genesis, that a group called the Elohim, which is a plural term, literally meaning the lofty ones, translated God, said to each other, "Let us," in the plural, "let us fashion the Adam." Adam comes from Adama, which is earth, so Adam, literally earthling. "Let us fashion the earthling in our image and after our likeness." And this is essentially in one biblical verse what the Sumerian tales tell in quite a number of creation texts. And then after they achieved that and everything seemed to be in order, the deluge came and destroyed everything. So after the deluge, then, and there are tales, by the way, Sumerian tales describing the deluge and its reasons and its what caused it and why was one god angry and said, "Let mankind perish," etc., etc. That's it's another evening. So after the deluge, when the water subsided, they had to restruct and recreate and restart everything from the beginning. And they could not do it anymore in the Edin, today's Mesopotamia or Iraq, because it was all covered with millions, or now one should say billions, of tons of mud, and nothing could be done there until the earth would would take generations and generations to dry. So they shifted their whole project from where it was. If you recall, it was this way. Everything was anchored on Mount Ararat, the twin peaks of Ararat, which stand out as a marker, and laid out exactly the same idea of a landing corridor this way. Now they used as one of the facilities to serve their purposes a great platform that they had built here and that survived the deluge right here. And again, using this notion of equidistance from there to the spaceport, which was here and here, to create the whole landing pattern, they chose a new mission control center, a new place for the Durranki, right here. And this place is known today as Jerusalem. So Jerusalem, and I sometimes, either at seminars or when I took groups with me to tour these places, I would say to them, why is Jerusalem sacred? I said, well, it is sacred to Muslims because the tale is that Muhammad was taken from Mecca or Medina one night on a winged horse and brought to Jerusalem, and there he was taken aloft and visited heaven for one night. So that's But why was Muhammad taken to Jerusalem? Why wasn't he lifted just from Mecca or Medina? Well, because that place was already known as a sacred place, because the Christians believed that that's where Jesus preached and was crucified, etc. So I said, so why was Jesus crucified in Jerusalem? He was born in Bethlehem. He came from Nazareth. Why Jerusalem? Well, because that's where the temple was, the Jewish temple, the Temple of Solomon. So why was the Temple of Solomon there? Well, people don't know. So I tell them, well, it was there because the same Anunnaki who had this pattern and had Nippur as the navel of the earth and mission control center before the deluge set up this layout and made Jerusalem mission control center after the deluge. And equidistant from it is the spaceport and twin peaks emulating the twin peaks of Ararat, twin peaks are here in the Sinai Peninsula, and twin peaks, artificial ones, because there were no mountains there. So they built two mountains known as the Giza pyramids. Now, things did not go so well after the reconstruction and the setting up of the alternate mission control center. The Anunnaki, who, according to the tales by Enki and others, were engaged in almost constant wars on their planet, had at the time a leader called Anu, but he was actually a usurper. He usurped the throne. And under the Sumerian sexagesimal system of 6 times 10, 60, etc., he ranked as the top rank 60. And his successor was a son called Enlil, who was given the rank 50. But Enlil was not the firstborn son. It was Ea, or Enki, as previously known as Ea, Enki, who was really the rightful successor, but he was demoted to rank 40, and so on. So there was a pantheon of 12, matching the 12 members of the solar system, and matching other 12 without belaboring it, 12 months of the year, 12 tribes of Israel, 12 disciples of Jesus, and so on. So 12 was a celestial number. So the relationships were such that the conflict was almost inevitable, especially since it had a lot to do of who was mothered by whom, who was the father, who was the mother, if this one was also the son of Anu and Antu, then he was this rank, but if this one was only the son of this one, but not this queen, he had another rank. So the relationship was quite confused and convoluted and leading to conflict, which soon appeared on Earth. And one of the events that took place, not too many years after the establishment of that great pattern of landing pattern in Jerusalem and the Space Force, etc., and the two artificial mountains in Egypt, was that wars broke out. And the first war that I named in my book, The Wars of Gods and Men, the Pyramid Wars, because there was a series of them, had to do with these facilities, because in the Great Pyramid, one of the two especially, which is the only one that has an ascending passage and chambers, all the others have just a descending passage, they were a prize that one side tried to deprive from the other. And the first series of pyramid wars took place there. In that particular war, the two main protagonists were the main son of Enlil, called Ninurta, and the main son of Enki, called Marduk. And in that war, it was Ninurta who was the victor. And his victory was commemorated in some cylinder seals and other depictions. This was his symbol, the eagle. And this was his victory's depiction, how he won the war over the two pyramids. And another depiction where you see actually all three pyramids. And this, by the way, is another of the proofs of which I have many, and I deal with it extensively, of who built the pyramids and where they were built, and that you see that already in Sumerian times, which preceded the pharaonic times by thousands of years, the existence of the pyramids was already known. Around 2900 BC, a Sumerian king called Gilgamesh went in search of immortality. Now, the whole business of immortality doesn't really exist, because all the tales tell us that these so-called gods, the Anunnaki, were both born and died. And there are tales about both births and death. But it is all relative. That's why the Greeks called the gods, they borrowed the Sumerian pantheon, they called them the immortals. But it was only a difference in what a year is. If the Anunnaki come from a planet whose orbit is about 3,600 of our years, to them it is 1 year. If you would ask an Anunnaki, how old are you? He'll say, whatever, I'm 20 years old, which means my planet, Nibiru, made 20 rounds around the sun. If you ask somebody here, so we won't ask people for their ages, of course, but you ask how old are you, and he'll answer, it means my planet, where I grew up, to which I genetically belong, made X number of orbits around the sun. That's a year. So, but anyway, Gilgamesh was the son of a goddess. And he felt, he came to his mother, and he actually was not only a demigod, but he was two-thirds divine, because his mother, not his father, his mother was a god, a goddess. And he said, if I'm two-thirds divine, two-thirds Anunnaki genetically, why should I die like a mortal? And she said to him, you're right, but in order to attain our longevity, you have to go and be on our planet. So he went in search of immortality, and the Epic of Gilgamesh is a well-known literary work from antiquity, translated in antiquity already in many of those ancient languages. Now, where did Gilgamesh go in search of immortality? He had to go to places from which he would be taken aloft to the planet of the gods. So if you remember this design, this is what I showed you. This is Jerusalem, which is only Mission Control Center. He had, and this one, where is it? This one was destroyed in the Pyramid Wars. So he had two places to go. One was the great platform in the mountains here, and one was the spaceport itself. And so around 2900 BC, almost 5,000 years ago, he went in search of a place to be taken aloft and join the gods on their planet. Now, the first one that I showed you, this one, is in the mountains of Lebanon. The great cedar forest there is depicted and described in detail in the epic tale of Gilgamesh. And the text says that he witnessed on the night before he entered or tried to enter the place, he saw a rocket launched. And lo and behold, archaeologists have discovered a Phoenician coin from a place not far from there that shows the great platform and a rocket ship on a podium. So it did exist. Now that place still exists and can be visited. I went there at some risk. I would not advise you to go at this time because it's the headquarters of the Hezbollah in Lebanon. But the place is called Baalbek, and there is there a vast stone platform of about 500,000 square feet. And here at this northwestern corner, there are ruins of temples built over temples over temples. The latest one are Muslim and Byzantine and Roman, but they are built over a platform that pre-existed. And these are some of the most ancient ruins that you see there, of levels that keep rising from down there, rising and rising and rising and rising and rising. And these stone blocks weigh between 600 to 900 tons each. And the immensity of the place is mind-boggling. Even more mind-boggling is one of the courses in the western wall of that enclave, on the western wall, on top of these huge boulders. And this, the three of them, one, two, and the third one, called known as the Trilithon. This is the drawing, the image. This is a line drawing of a person, so you can see the scale. So there are three of these huge stone blocks lying in one of the courses, one of the levels, next to each other. And they weigh 1,100 tons each. Now, there is no piece of equipment, even today, that can lift 1,100 tons, or even 1,000 tons, or even 600 tons. There's no such piece of equipment. Yet, and this is a photograph, by the way, I think, can you see that little ant there? That's me. I'm standing there. And this is one, the first Trilithon, and then there are two more. Now we know where they came from, because about a mile and a half away, there is the quarry from which those stone blocks were cut and lifted and brought. And one of them is unfinished. So right here, it's still part of the native rock, and this part has been already cut. And again, this is me there. So you can see the size. So somebody in antiquity, and according to all the evidence before the flood, cut those stones and lifted them over a mile and a half and put them there, not on, drop them on the ground, but put them exactly where they should be, where they belong. And the question is, what was the purpose of this whole thing? As I said, Gilgamesh reported that he saw a rocket ship launch there, and the Phoenician coin also depicted. And it was only after I saw photographs of about a year ago, I think, of the Chinese launching their spacecraft for the first time. Now, we are used to launch towers made of metal and so on, but this is also built out of some kind of stone. So I have no doubt that what we see there because this is exactly the same thing as the Chinese have built, because this starts somewhere there and goes down and down and down and down to well below ground. So this was a launch site to which Gilgamesh went around 5,000 years ago in order to be lofted to the planet of the gods, Nibiru. But he failed. There's a whole tale that he had a companion and they killed the sacred bull, the bull of heaven, and had to escape for their life. So it didn't work. So he went, he didn't give up. He went to the other destination, which, if you recall a previous slide, was the spaceport in the Sinai Peninsula. And what was there, we also know, because the Egyptian has depicted it, and this is a depiction found in the tomb of an Egyptian called Hui, who was the governor in ancient times of the Sinai Peninsula. And in his tomb, the burial chamber is surrounded on the walls with depictions of scenes from the lands where he was an official. And this is from the Sinai, and I think you can see that this is an underground silo, because you see the ground level with trees and giraffes, etc., and you see it multi-stage rocket ship and the command module sticking out from above ground. So this is what existed in the Sinai Peninsula. Oops, we go forward. Right. And again, like in the Sumerian tales, there are Egyptian texts there. The collection is called the Book of the Dead, because the Egyptian pharaohs claimed that they have, by being a pharaoh, they were divine, semi-divine, demigods, and had the right after they died, in an afterlife, to join the gods in an afterlife. So after they died, according to the Book of the Dead, they went on a simulated journey to the spaceport, to where the spacecraft or rocket ships are, and then to be taken aloft. And this, and the Book of the Dead has many illustrations. This is just one of them that shows the four pilots that welcomed him aboard the spacecraft, one of the pharaohs. So there's no doubt that there too the facility for being taken aloft did exist. However, it does not exist anymore. Baalbek still exists in ruins, but the spaceport in the Sinai does not exist, because in one of the next wars between the various clans of the Anunnaki, the Enlilites, the Enkiites, Ninurta, Marduk, etc., they resorted to the use of nuclear weapons. And the spaceport in the Sinai was a target. And you can see to this day two things. One is you can see the immense cavity to this day from space. This is a NASA photograph, and the crack in the peninsula is the result. And if you go there, which I did by myself and with a group, if you go there, you find in that particular spot, you find in the middle of pure white limestone mountains. Everything is pure white. You see a huge field with broken, burnt, and totally blackened rocks. And one of the visits, I took samples. They were tested. There's possibly some radioactivity, but it's inconclusive. But in 2024, almost 4,000 years ago, the Anunnaki resorted to the use of nuclear weapons. There is a long text called the Era Epic, E-R-R-A, Epic, that describes the reasons, who did it, how they did it, what the number of nuclear weapons that were used in 2024. The unintended consequence of that was that a wind blowing from the Mediterranean brought what they called, in those texts, they're called lamentation texts, they called the evil wind that brought death to everything alive in Sumer. As the nuclear wind passed, reaching from the Sinai to Sumer, it did not destroy anything. The lamentation text lament that the stalls stand, but the animals that were there are all dead. The houses stand, but everybody who lived in the houses lies dead in the streets, on the roofs, etc. And that was the end of the great Sumerian civilization about 2024 BC. And in that one, unlike in the previous wars, where Ninurta, the son of Enlil, was the victor, Marduk, the son of Enki, was the victor, and that was the beginning of the rise of Babylon. Instead of Sumerian and Enlil, and all the others, it was now the era and the time of Marduk and the Babylonians. Now we are starting to leave ancient history, and we are starting, or I'm starting, to take you by the hand and lead you not only to the present, but also to the future, and to understand where history is taking us. This map is the key to it, and please try to remember it. If you recall the layout of the landing corridor from Mount Ararat this way, and Jerusalem as Mission Control Center, the spaceport, the Giza pyramids, and the place in Lebanon called Baalbek today. These are the four space-related sites that if you keep them in mind, you understand what happened afterwards, what happened in recent times, and what the present conflict is all about. When the dust, let's use that expression, the dust of the nuclear explosion and the demise of Sumer settled, several hundred years later, when perhaps passage was possible again after the use of nuclear weapons here, a major event took place. It is called the Exodus of the Israelites from Egypt. And the Bible says that after about 400 years, God remembered. He said, oh, by the way, I forgot all about those people. There was this guy, Abraham, and I promised him a certain land, the promised land. I made a covenant with him. And then I forgot all about it. But now it's time. It's time to fulfill my promises. And the Israelites left Egypt. And I didn't write it yet in any of my books, but I can tell you now that if I ever do, I will tell you that the starting point of the Exodus was the Sphinx, because the Sphinx gazes precisely along the 30th parallel towards the spaceport. There was, of course, no more spaceport there, but the mountains remained, and the mountain which held the various facilities was there, and the Bible calls it Mount Sinai, the mount in the Sinai Peninsula, Har Elohim, the mountain of the gods, of the Anunnaki. So they were sent here on this Exodus to resume the relationship, the commandments, etc., etc., which required for them to proceed to accept all the moral teachings of the Sumerians. I think in my very first book, The 12th Planet, and when I talk about the Sumerian law codes, I say everybody, most people know about the ancient law codes, Hammurabi, the Babylonian king. His law code, which is on a stone block in the Louvre in Paris, is a code of crime and punishment. It says, if you did this, that's your punishment. The Sumerian law codes, and there's one, for example, by a king 1,000 years before Hammurabi, 1,400 years before Hammurabi. It was a law code of justice that said you shall not take away the donkey of a widow. You shall not delay the wages of a day laborer. Those were the Sumerian law codes. So these were the Sumerian commandments, the Sumerian moral laws that had to be reaccepted. Renegotiated at Mount Sinai. And once they were, they had to continue. There was difficulty in going straight. They went around. But anyway, finally, they got to Jerusalem. And what did they do once they got to Jerusalem? They built the temple to Yahweh on a platform that existed there. And if you have not done it yet, I urge you to go to Jerusalem, because along the Western Wall, this, of course, doesn't exist anymore. This is now replaced by a Muslim structure. Along this Western Wall, just as along the Western Wall in Baalbek, in the landing place of Gilgamesh, this is an aerial photograph. This is the area that's called the Temple Mountain. And this is where the temple stood. and the Holy of Holies and the Ark of the Covenant. Interestingly enough, that I noticed when I was there and when looking at there, that there are trees everywhere, but not here. Nothing grows here. So this is the Western Wall, and an opening was made along the Western Wall after being blocked for thousands of years. And what was discovered there is mind-boggling, because in the same place, the Western Wall, as in the landing place where Gilgamesh went, there is a trilithon, not of 1,100,000 tons, but only 600 or 700 tons, three immense stone blocks lying one next to the other, just as there, and somewhere there, anyway, somewhere there, there is a sign that says that this is exactly where a tunnel leads to the Holy of Holies on above the platform. And this is another shot of the trilithon in Jerusalem. Now, when Yahweh, the God of the Bible, commanded David and then Solomon to build a temple exactly on a pre-existing platform, this is what he said. These are exact words in translation. And if you, I cannot read from this angle. Will anybody read out loud, please?
Thus has said the Lord Yahweh, this is Jerusalem. In the midst of the nations I placed her, and all the lands are in a circle round about her.
Well, in the midst of the nations, in the center of the circles. Well, that could not be more explicit that this is the layout of the Mission Control Center. Now, at about the time that the Hebrews, the Israelites, were restoring the platform in Jerusalem, other things were happening in the adjoining countries, especially those countries that followed Marduk, the Babylonian one. In Babylonia, on cylinder seals, the sign of the cross began to appear. In Assyria, the kings began to wear the sign of the cross on their chest. The same happened in Egypt. Now, these are all from around 1000 BC, 900 BC, 800 BC, 700 BC. Now, what does it mean? What does it signify? Well, the sign of the cross, it may come as a surprise to my Christian friends, the sign of the cross is not a new sign, and not a sign developed or invented at the time of Jesus. This is a very ancient Sumerian sign, and each time that the planet Nibiru, that usually was depicted as a winged disk, was on its way back to our vicinity, each time that the reappearance of Nibiru was expected, the depiction, the symbolism for Nibiru, for the planet, changed from the winged disk to the cross. So this one, for example, this is the one of the most ancient ones. This is another one. This is when agriculture was granted to mankind, and so on. And if you look at the orbit of Nibiru, roughly 3,600 years, I, in my book, The End of Days, I explain why the orbit might have become a little shorter, only 3,450 years. But anyway, we can work with this 3,600, which is a good round number and part of the sexagesimal system. 6, 10, 60, 360, 3,600. So from the time that Nibiru was in our vicinity, making the great round around the sun, which is called the perigee, the point closest to the sun, it goes out, slows down, reaches this point, the apogee, and then starts on its way back. So at some point, the planet is here, or here, or here, or here, or here, or here, and at some point, the anticipation of its return begins. And that's I suggest, is when the sign of the cross began to reappear. In one of my books, The Wars of Gods and Men, I deal with all the various wars that took place, not only the very early ones, but in particular the ones that started to become more frequent and more ferocious as the return of Nibiru became closer and closer. It seems as if it became much more important who would be in control, who would welcome them, whose particular aspect of religion would be more predominant, etc. And it was at that time, precisely around 750 BC, that the biblical prophecies also started. They started with the prophet Amos around 750 BC. Now, in general, no distinction is made by people writing on the subject, and most of whom really don't know Hebrew, so they rely on translations. The whole thing, biblical prophecy, is taken as a as one lump subject. But if you know Hebrew, and if you study the various prophecies in great detail, and know the precision of the Hebrew language, you begin to see that the prophets were really talking about two different things. One was called the Day of the Lord, and Amos spoke about it. Another, I think, I quote Habakkuk, I can't see from this angle. anyway, they started to talk about the Day of the Lord. The Day of the Lord is coming. The Day of the Lord is near, and it was described as a time of celestial phenomena. There would be darkness at noon. You will not be able to see the stars at night. The moon will not shine its light, etc. and so on and so forth. I don't know if it's easy for you. I had about 30 slides with all these biblical quotations, but I realized that it would be very difficult even for the audience to read them. So at the same time, similar prophecies known as Akkadian prophecies, Assyrian prophecies, Babylonian prophecies, began to also talk about the return, the celestial Lord would come from the south, would be first seen in this constellation, and so on. And I drew some of these charts to show you and show how you can relate some of the text to the progress of Nibiru coming back to Earth's vicinity. this is another sketch that really renders as a sketch literal wording, saying you first can see it from there, then you can see it here, and so on and so forth as the planet returns. There were even discoveries of astronomical records. These are called astrolabes because they depict the circular heavens around Earth on plain paper with all the stars being named, where the progression of Nibiru from being seen in this part of the heavens to being seen in this part of the heavens at its apogee, its perigee, is actually recorded as having been witnessed and seen by Assyrian and Babylonian astronomers. Well, this is one of the texts accompanying one of the astrolabes. And as becomes obvious as you study all these texts, that the main feature they are talking about is a day of darkness, darkness at noon, the sun will not be seen, etc., which we can say they are really talking about a solar eclipse. And the Assyrian records, I think that's what I showed in the previous slide, talk about a darkness at noon and an eclipse at an unexpected time. because all these eclipses could be predicted. They had enough knowledge to predict solar eclipses, lunar eclipses, etc. So in exactly 556 BC, and this is a sketch, a sky map prepared by NASA, not by me, in 556, an unusual and unexpected eclipse darkness at noon took place. And it is my conclusion in the book, The End of Days, that that is exactly when Nibiru last was near Earth and created that eclipse. So if you go back to the problem posed by 2012, and you say, well, 2012 is when Nibiru is expected to return and do this or do that, be a good omen or bring harmful things, will be the apocalypse, the end, it does not work. Because the last time that Nibiru was near Earth was 556 BC. And if it has an orbit of about 3,600, 3,400, 3,500 years, it ain't coming back in 2012. So what might happen, if not in 2012, in some other time, in our lifetimes, perhaps? And this takes me to the other part, which of the biblical prophecies, where I told you that there were really two things that were discussed and prophesied, from about 750 BC to about 550 BC, the time of Ezekiel. They spoke about the day of the Lord, the celestial Lord. It's coming, it's nearing, it's coming from the south, it will darken the skies, etc., etc. But then the other part, they switched to a term called Acharit HaYamim, the end of days, which some translate end time or any other way people want to translate. But the time, the question is, what do we mean by time? But whatever we call time will come to an end. And we have to remember, and this is the purpose of this slide to show you, that the Anunnaki were coming and going between their planet and the Earth, not necessarily when Nibiru was closest to Earth. As a matter of fact, they could not do that, because it is at this point that the planet, their planet, that slows down here, gains speed and moves fastest around the sun. So the only way they could come here was if they left their planet ahead of time and speeded ahead of the planet and were here and then rejoined their planet, or when the planet was starting on the way back to slow down, then they would, as if literally, fall back towards the sun and come to our vicinity. So there were all kinds of ways, and there are tales. There are tales about this god, this goddess. There is a tale about a king called the Tana, who was taken to heaven. He was afraid to continue the trip, and he started to see the earth become smaller and smaller. There was one of the sons of Enki by an earthling woman called Adapa, who was taken for a visit with Anu in heaven, taken and brought back. So he did not stay 3,600 years on Nibiru. So comings and goings are possible even when Nibiru is not precisely at its closest to us. And what did happen in 556 BC, when so many of the other nations expected the Anunnaki to show up again, is that instead of showing up, they left. I don't have the slides here, and I'm not intending to spend more time because I'm way beyond my time already. But in the book, I suggest that the point of departure was the famous Nazca lines in South America. But what is without doubt known, and this is perhaps part of the Mayan prophecies, is that the chief deity of Mesoamerica, whom the Aztecs called Quetzalcoatl, the Mayan called Kukulkan, which all meant the plumed or the winged serpent, before he left, he said, this is written down, he said, I will return, I promise to return. And he promised to return at a certain point, which is related to the Mesoamerican calendars. Now, the so-called Mayan calendar, where the whole business of 2012 appears, is really a calendar called the Long Count, which was started not by the Mayas, was started by the Olmecs, people from Africa who were brought over by Quetzalcoatl, that I identified as the Egyptian god Thoth, were brought over in 3113 BC. And this is the calendar that the Mayas used. The whole business of 2012 is based because the calendar, its various symbols depict one day or 20 days or 360 days, etc. And this is this one is called the Baktun, and 13 Baktuns will culminate in, by some calculation, 2012. Now, it depends how one calculates, because it depends if you divide the days by 365 or by 360. One way that has been suggested only a century ago really arrives at 2087 as the Mayan 13th Baktun. But in general, my feeling is that it is not applicable at all, because if you follow the biblical prophecies, they are dealing with a cyclical timetable. This so-called Mayan calendar is a linear one, like day one, day two, day three, etc., the same as the AD calendar. 2000, 2001. Why nothing happened in 2000? Because after 2000 came 2001. Like I showed you at the beginning, that some said 2000, then said 2003, 2000. All the predictions in the Bible, both the Old Testament and the New Testament, speak of a cycle. The beginning will be the ending. The ending is the beginning. The past is the future, and this can take place only in a cyclical thing. And what was, here's more quotes of the same subject about the end of days and what will happen there. Now, the best clues in the Old Testament about this whole business of the end of days, when will it be, not only what will happen, but when will it be, is in the book of Daniel. I just almost skipped fast because it takes too long to start reading all that. But one of those that really devoted the better part of his life to studying the meaning of the prophecies and the timetable given in the book of Daniel. There's some number of years and number of years, but the best clue is where the angels tell Daniel, the end of days will come after half time, time, and two times. And Daniel, like we say, what do you mean by that? What half time are you talking about? Are you not talking about football, right? And he was left with no answer. So Sir Isaac Newton, who is known more about celestial orbits and such other things, spent most of his time delving into those prophecies and trying to calculate them. And a handwritten document by him came to light relatively recently, two, 3 years ago. And when it came to light, the news headlines were that Sir Isaac Newton calculated the end of days at 2160 AD. I was fortunate to be able to obtain a photocopy of that handwritten page, which is written front and back. In the book, The End of Days, I give what it says, I quote what it says. I do not show the photographs because I have no permission to do that. So you are now seeing, you are the first ones to see the photograph of the handwritten document by Sir Isaac Newton. And he calculated also in three ways. And the number 2160 does indeed feature heavily in his calculations. But when I looked at his calculations on the back of the page, I said, oh my God, he's talking about zodiacal times. Because one of the things, again, a so-called Sumerian first, was the devising of the zodiac, of calculating how the earth on the first day of spring here, after a full year, does not precisely return to where it was, but is slightly retarded. The retardation amounts to 1 degree of 360 in 72 years, and a 30 degree zodiacal house, therefore 30 times 72 is 2160. So the mathematical zodiacal time is 2160 years. And there's no doubt, though, the beginning of the zodiac is attributed to the Greeks, that the Sumerians knew it. They named all the 12 zodiacal constellations in the correct order. This is all Sumerian names. They depicted them the way we still use to this day. So there's no doubt that they knew the zodiacal times. But again, as with other things, how could they? How could any immortal Sumerian not only measure the delay of 1 degree in 72 years, but of 30 degrees of the shift from one zodiacal house to another in 2160 years? And the answer is that, again, this was an Anunnaki device and not a Sumerian device. And what is important to keep in mind is that the time scale, so that's perhaps when the ancients told Daniel time, half time, two times, that they were talking about divine time, the Anunnaki time, is because I asked myself, and I give that answer also in the book, The End of Days, is what prompted, what caused the Anunnaki in 2024 BC to resort to the use of nuclear weapons? What, what was the problem? And the problem was that Marduk said that the age of the bull, the age of Taurus, which was the age of Enlil, is ending, he said, and my age, the age of the ram, the age of Aries, is beginning. He claimed that this is the correct zodiacal scale. So he said around 2200 BC, the age of Enlil, the age of Taurus, has ended, and my age, the age of Aries, has begun. The others, and this is all in those texts, by the way, the others said to him, no, you are wrong, because don't go by some chart. Look at the heavens. In the heavens, on the first day of spring, we are still in the age of the bull. We are still in the age of Taurus. Why? Because the three zodiacal constellations of the bull, of the ram, and of Pisces are not the same size. So, though Marduk claimed that his age has already begun, it was still observationally, really in the heavens, the age of still of Enlil, of his rivals, Ninurta, and so on. So this was such a bitter fight that they resorted to nuclear weapons to deprive each other of the spaceport. Now, there is another cylinder seal. It is at the Hermitage Museum in Russia. There's no doubt about its date. It's 2500 BC. And it shows, in my opinion, without doubt, an astronaut on the sixth planet, which is Mars, greeting an astronaut on the seventh planet, which is Earth. You remember, I asked you to keep it in mind, Earth and its moon. And between them, there is a spacecraft. So a return of the Anunnaki with a stopover on Mars, one greeting the other, has occurred. And there is a date. There is a date on this cylinder seal. Do you see the date? Pisces, the age of Pisces. The age of Pisces. So does this mean that the return of the Anunnaki and the end of days with its 2160-year calculation will still come about this century? Maybe. Because. There is a because, ladies and gentlemen. Because just at the place that in according to the New Testament is called Armageddon, where the final war will take place, a mosaic floor in the first church ever built in the Holy Land, in the time of Jesus, has on its floor the sign of Pisces. This was discovered 2 or 3 years ago at Armageddon, which really means in Hebrew Har Megiddo, the Mount of Megiddo, which is in Israel. Now, are all these omens, or is it just a tale to tell you at ARE? I don't know. I believe that these are omens. I think it was Yogi Berra who said, I'm paraphrasing, that predicting is a risky business, except especially if it's about the future. So to deal both with Armageddon and a prophecy of the return is a difficult and serious subject. And when I started writing my books, which began almost 40 years ago, the first book was titled The 12th Planet, I knew then, almost 40 years ago, that whatever volume the final one in that series called The Earth Chronicles will be, it will have to deal with the end of days, which is the name given by the Bible, in the Bible, to prophecies of the last days, the end time, and any other way that the term in Hebrew, which is Acharit HaYamim, is rendered. And I really delayed writing that final book for two reasons. Number one is that I felt I need to do more research and actually it took another 30 years of research to be able to give a plausible answer, one which I believe is the correct answer, but at least it should be sufficiently documented to be plausible. And the other reason is that I don't know if everybody will be happy with the conclusions of that book, The End of Days. Certainly, I think many of those that are dealing, specializing in the subject of what's about to happen, have focused recently on 2012 AD. If I wanted to be nasty, which maybe I should be, is I will tell you right off that the only thing certain about 2012 that there'll be another presidential election then, and that no matter who you vote for this time, you will say, let's get rid of the bomb. because otherwise, what is supposed to happen in 2012? It is mostly linked with the so-called Mayan calendar or Mayan prophecies, and I'll talk about it in greater detail as we go along. But as I understand what others are saying, is that it is a time that something, the present, the past, will come to an end, and something will happen. And when you are pressing those others who specialize in 2012, and you ask them what will happen, they say, well, there's a planet. There's a planet that makes some great orbit and periodically comes to our vicinity, and at that time it causes all kinds of havoc. And in connection or in response to such kinds of prophecies, my answer is that, to remind the audience that the same claims were made in regard, I don't know why, but in regard to 2003, and that that's when the planet, the unknown planet, Planet X, will arrive and do all kinds of unpleasant things to us, or maybe good things. And if you will recall, the same kind of prophecies were connected with the millennium, the year 2000. And one way or another, they are always coming back to Planet X. And if you say, what is Planet X? Oh, that is the planet about which this guy Sitchin has been writing. So what is this Planet X, and when really is it supposed to come back to our vicinity, and what is supposed to happen when it does? I started to write about it, as many of you may know, in my first book, The 12th Planet. It took me more than 30 years to research that material for that book. It was published the first time in 1976. The English, not hardcover and softcover, but the paperback edition, which is still selling everywhere, had about 50 printings by now, which is a record for the publishers. And the book has been translated into some 24 languages. And I can share with you a personal irritation, and that is that one recent night I was awakened from a sleep, which is not easy for me lately to fall asleep. And the phone, which is also a fax machine, rang around 12:30 a.m. And when I checked who's trying to reach me at this time, fax from Hanoi that the publisher in Vietnam wants to translate into Vietnamese, the 12th planet. And though, you know, it's been translated by now to almost any language you can think of, I was thinking to myself, somebody in Vietnam, in Hanoi, after all that that place means to us, this is really something. Now what I did in the 12th planet, and maybe that is the reason for its success and for its still being so powerfully around, is that I brought to life a civilization that was hardly known before, and that is the Sumerian civilization. I find it, although now more and more I find in articles, in other books, etc., reference to the Sumerian civilization, to the Sumerians, I find that it's still easier for even those who deal with that, like museums, to say Babylonian. For example, there is now in Europe an exhibit from ancient Mesopotamia where three museums, the one in London, in Paris, and in Berlin, have combined to put together some of their objects and show them in each one of the three places. And they refer to it as the Babylonian exhibit. So almost 40 years ago, when I or anybody else would say to somebody, well, you know, the Sumerian civilization, you would get some kind of a blank look. You know, the Sumerian, you know, what are you talking about? So I brought to life the Sumerian civilization, which was really a most amazing civilization. It blossomed out in what is now southern Iraq, in that part of the world. This is the ancient Near East. This is the Mediterranean Sea, the Red Sea, Egypt, Assyria, Turkey, which was the Hittites then, etc. So about 6,000 years ago, an incredible civilization appeared there, and all those that deal with it use such words as suddenly, unexpectedly, out of nowhere, because there was no gradual or any kind of precedential civilization that you had this and this and this, and this is was a higher level, a higher stage. Suddenly, from what we may call primitive, though they were not primitive people, but you know, they were farmers, hunters, etc. But suddenly there appeared cities, high-rise buildings, societal organization, kings, priests, codes of law, literature, art, music, musical instruments, all of that within a very short period appeared about 6,000 years ago. And I sometimes find it necessary to ask people to stop for a minute and think, what is 6,000 years? So we are about 2,000 years removed from the time of Jesus. Now, that time was about 2,000 years removed from the time of Abraham. And then add to that another 2,000 years, and that's where we are talking about, where this great civilization appeared so suddenly. And without devoting the whole evening to that civilization and all the firsts to which we owe a debt. For example, if you look at your watch and you have 60 minutes in an hour, why do you have 60 minutes? Because that's the basic Sumerian mathematical system called sexagesimal base 60. They went from 1 to 60, and then, like we go from 1 to 100 and 101, then we go, they went from 1 to 60 and then 61, so there was base 60. A circle has 360 degrees. Why? Because it is 60 times 6. Indeed, the whole Sumerian mathematical system was based on that. 6 × 10 × 6 × 10, etc. So you had 6 × 60 × 360 × 3600 and so on and so forth, up to very high numbers in going. Some tablets were found with starting with mathematical tables with 2,196,000 and tables of division from that. So the legacy of Sumer, be it in the first wheel and so on and so forth, is really incredible. So, but I want to mention tonight at least three of their first. One is writing. And they developed a writing system called cuneiform, where the scribe using a stylus would make wedge-like symbols or indentations in wet clay, which when it dried would become a permanent record. I don't have a sample of a tablet with me, but let's say that this is a clay tablet, and I once held up a copy of my book, not this one, this is a DVD, and I said, which one of the two do you think would last another 1,000 years? The printed book or the clay tablet? And the answer is the clay tablet. So we have writing, which of course meant a language and grammar and literature and epic tales, and lullabies were written down, recipes, for example, in the book, The 12th Planet, I give as an example a recipe for what the French call coq au vin, meaning a chicken cooked in wine. There were proverbs. It's really mind-boggling, but I won't spend the whole evening on that. So writing was one of them. Another thing was pictorial depictions. They took stones, mostly semi-precious stones, and made cylinders about an inch or so, sometimes longer, but basically about an inch, a cylinder of an inch, and would engrave, and nobody has figured out to this day how, in this hard stone, they would make an engraving in reverse, like a negative, which when wrote